Ciao, I am Renato Flores, the publisher of old entertaining scholarly books on Rudo Valentino by Evelyn Zumaya. I'm here today with Evelyn to discuss more about her work. Ciao, Evelyn.
Ciao, Renato. As listeners of this podcast know, in these episodes, we are talking about my research discoveries, which became the basis for my Rudolph Valentino biography, Affairs Valentino. So much defamatory fiction has been spread online about me and my work that these podcasts are my way of setting the record straight. My research revealed unique aspects of Valentino's life, and those will be the topics I will focus on here. Today I want to open this episode by discussing a Spanish artist who visited Rudolph Valentino and his wife Natasha Rombova in the summer of 1925, Federico Beltran Massis.
So, who was Federico Beltran Massis, and how did he know the Valentinos?
Beltran Massis was a well-known Spanish portrait painter who was born in Cuba. He worked in Barcelona and Madrid, and as an artist myself, I greatly admire his work. He used a dark and deeply rich palette, and his compositions are exotic and almost primitive. I can see why Rudy and Natasha would be drawn to his work. They were both artists with a taste for the exotic and intense colors. In any case, back to my story here, and I'm going to call him Federico. Do you think that's okay? I'm not being too casual.
No.
Federico says he met Rudy and Natasha in New York, and Ullman recalls that they first met him in Seville. Whatever the case, the Valentinos invited him to visit them in Hollywood. When Federico arrived in Los Angeles, his timing could not have been worse. He walked into a war zone in the Valentino home. Rudy and Natasha were weeks away from their final split. Tensions were unbearable, and Rudy welcomed his Spaniard friend Federico as someone to spend time with and a shoulder to cry on. Natasha was never home, usually on the set of her movie, What Price Beauty, and there were reports she had taken a lover and was taking medication.
Tell me about the painting Federico did while he was in Los Angeles.
Well, again, as an artist, I can say that he must have been a very efficient painter because he completed so many impressive portraits during his Hollywood tenure. He must have painted from dawn to dusk. It was an impressive body of work. He would paint four paintings for the Valentinos, two of Rudy, one in Moorish costume for The Hooded Falcon, the movie that was never made, and the other as the Gaucho. This painting is now housed in the Utah Museum of Fine Art. A third portrait of Natasha in Spanish dress, reclining as Goya's Maya, and the fourth portrait, which inspired the title of this podcast episode, was La Gitana, a Spanish gypsy, reclining also as Goya's Maya, only in this painting she is nude. Natasha did not seem to be so comfortable with having large portraits of her about, especially nude ones, but Rudy loved the nude Gitana and hung it over his bed at Falcon Lair.
So he hung this over the bed at Falcon Lair, didn't he? Even though he and Natasha were separated then, I think that is a sign of great love, still very strong, don't you?
Yes, theirs was a great love. Her mother would write how she felt they were both too impetuous, headstrong, and artistically focused to be very compatible, but she also believed they shared a genuine and deep love. Their suffering as a couple in love was so publicly displayed, played out in front of family members, the staff in their homes, that it is desperately false for anyone to even imply that this was some platonic marriage of convenience. That is an utter lie. So back to the Beltran Massis story. He lands in the midst of Rudy believing Natasha is having an affair and cheating on him, and she's thinking the same thing about Rudy. She had her handyman spy on Rudy, and she was hearing all about his private lunches with his beautiful co-stars in the studio bungalow. They were seldom home, but when they were, battles raged.
So how does Beltran Massis play into this story?
Well, he painted many portraits in Hollywood, and a showing was organized. This is a story Michael Morris, the author of Madame Valentino and my good friend, wrote about, so I'm going to cite his account of this from Madame Valentino on page 168, and I quote, "Some of Hollywood's biggest names attended the reception. Charlie Chaplin, Mary Pickford, Douglas Fairbanks, Harold Lloyd, Gloria Swanson, Tom Mix, Mae Murray, B.B. Daniels, Marion Davies, Colleen Moore, Barbara Lamar, John Barrymore, Irving Thalberg, and John Gilbert, among others. The journalist Adela Rogers St. John noted that the affair was a social triumph for the Valentinos, but Natasha's attitude, she complained, reduced the dazzling array of stars to nothing more than a royal court. Making her entrance 2 hours late, in jeweled turban and poiré robe, Madame Valentino regally progressed from room to room, wearing a sphinx-like smile and giving barely a nod to her guests, while Rudy trailed behind her, trying to be friendly and natural. When dinner had not yet been served by 10:30, the writer left in a huff. Her absence was noted by the hostess. At Rudy's insistence, she, Adela Rogers St. John, later wrote an apology to Natasha for her peasant-like behavior. She was hungry, she protested, and couldn't wait any longer. Rumbova did not respond to her apology, but the journalist had the last word by writing an unfavorable review of Natasha's conduct in her syndicated column. It was about this time that Belter and Masses suggested to Rudy that he hire detectives to follow Natasha. And I cite Allman's memoir here, page 63. Belter and Masses' presence in the house was good company for Rudy, since Natasha was at the studio on her picture almost all day and many times a good part of the night. Busy, she said, editing and cutting her completed picture. Belter and Masses, unaccustomed to wives such as Natasha, was suspicious of her outside activities and persuaded Rudy to have her shadowed for a few days. He told Rudy that if nothing was amiss, there wouldn't be any harm, but if there was, then Rudy should know about it. So it was on Federico's advice, Rudy asked George Allman to hire detectives, which George wrote that he thought this was a terrible idea. It turned out it was. When Rudy received the first detective's report, a fight between Rudy and Natasha ensued, which I write about in detail in Affairs Valentino, as related by George Allman in his 1975 memoir. I think it's logical to conclude that Natasha never knew that it was Federico Belter Masses who suggested Rudy have her followed. Because in a photograph taken in her home in Mallorca in the 1930s, Natasha is seen entertaining Federico as a guest in her home. In any case, Rudy and Natasha separated in a fury, and Rudy moved into Falcon Lair. Federico has his last footnote in the Valentino saga, as it were, when he saves Rudy's life. He found him sitting, holding a Browning pistol to his head, and lunged to grab the weapon just in time. Federico would return to Spain, but over the years, Renato, George Allman would be blamed for hiring those detectives to follow Natasha. In an article in the LA Times, which I referenced in Affairs Valentino, the press accosted Allman in his office. They badger him with questions about why Valentino would have his wife followed by detectives. Allman deflected the story, and Rudy, when he was questioned, said that George Allman would never hire detectives unless he was directed to do so. So for a while, the subject made a few headlines.
So, do you think this was one more thing people have accused Allman of doing when that was not the case? Why should this be believed?
Well, I think this is an important element in the version of Valentino's story stating that Rudy and Natasha's marriage was arranged. This premise is built largely on the falsehood that Allman wanted to break them up. I think the opposite was true. That myth has been created to vilify Allman, but doesn't it again portray Rudy as being not in control of his own life, his own love life, and his business? I think he made all of his own decisions and more. The vilification of Allman as having a plan to cause the Valentino's divorce is also used in the haloed version of Valentino's story, where he and his wife are the innocent victims of conniving evil people. I reject that portrayal of them 100%, as after my now 18 years of researching the Valentinos, I found them both to be aggressively shrewd, perceptive, passionate about each other, and honest. To say that their marriage was arranged is to lie about their reality, because there is no proof of that, only the self-serving fiction. I will quote a line Allman wrote when he said, quote, "This is an insult to the quality of Rudy's love for Natasha to even suggest such a thing." But somehow it's been permitted in those fictional versions of their marriage to portray Ullman as the villain. And I address this in more detail in Affairs Valentino, but I think in his later years, handyman Lou Mahoney also contributed to the idea that Ullman was acting against the Valentino's marriage. And more about that later. But at the time, Ullman was a happily married man with two small sons to support, and he had a demanding job. But he and his wife, Bea, were friends with Rudy and Natasha, and the four of them often dined together, especially when they were all in New York City. Natasha was driven out of Rudy's career by Joe Schenck, the head of United Artists, and this story is also carefully laid out in Affairs Valentino. But I will say that with the United Artists contract Rudy signed, I believe this instigated the separation. I was so surprised, Renato, when I first went through those court records that I retrieved to find a copy of that United Artists contract. Because until that moment, it was believed widely that Natasha was banned from Rudy's films in that contract, specifically named. But her name actually did not appear. According to Ullman, who negotiated that contract for Rudy, this was done in a memo received from Schenck, where he implicitly banned Natasha from the United Artists lot. At that point, there is zero reason for Ullman to meddle in Rudy's marriage and actually cause their divorce. What an absurd conclusion. Ullman needed that job and the stability of it. And all the evidence I uncovered revealed Ullman as a negotiator in the Battle Royale. He, as everyone else in their inner circle at the time, advised calm and restraint and hoped there could be a peaceful resolve. To portray George as a nefarious influence on either of them is more evidence of a long-standing vendetta, in my opinion. The vilification of Ullman began years after Rudy's death. Natasha was already excluded at the time from Rudy's films, and the film she did make, What Price Beauty, Ullman himself put up funds for it and signed loans in order to produce the film.
I know you had another point you want to make about the portrait Ullman as a villain.
Yes, as I just mentioned this, the vilification of Ullman was something that happened, I think, over the years, as Alberto and Jean Valentino told the story of the estate settlement. Certainly at the time of the hearing, when Alberto was challenging George Ullman's management of the estate, Lou Mahoney's appreciation of Ullman is very evident. Here in this article I have here dated November 11th, 1930, in the Los Angeles Times. The title is Valentino Case Gets Surprise, and I quote, Cleaning Enterprise, the section is called. Quote, Luther H. Mahoney, who described himself as superintendent of Valentino's estate, testified that he met the actor first in November 1925. He said that after Valentino's death, Ullman placed him in charge of the Ritz cleaners and enterprise the actor controlled. He said that Ullman was very busy trying to get money so that Valentino's employees could eat. He must have succeeded. The witness looks well fed, commented attorney Leonard H. Wilson. Mahoney is stout. Mahoney related that Ullman increased the auction sale price of Valentino's schooner after the actor's death by taking the vessel out of water and setting it up in Hollywood. Lou says it could sell for $100 in the water, but on land it sold eventually for $3,000, said Mahoney. And what was Alberto Guglielmi doing when you were conducting the Ritz cleaners? Asked Wilson. Quote, nothing, replied Mahoney. So I've often wondered, at what point and how and why did Lou Mahoney change his course of thinking so drastically about George Ullman?
I have been lately researching in the Gallic Archive, the French historical archive, and I found a few things which I have been translating from French.
Yes, you have, and thank you for your remarkable linguistic abilities. Your French comes in handy, doesn't it? Especially when we are in Morocco. But you found the Beltram Masses interview he gave shortly after Rudy's death, and I think the entire article is worth reading. And thank you for working on this complete translation.
Yes, so the article appeared on two magazines. The first one was the Commedia of September 25, 1926. And the second one on the magazine Le Spectacle, October 1st, 1926. And the article was written by the writer, actor, and journalist Guillaume Dessay.
So, the title of the article, I'm reading your translation, Valentino, His Revolver and the Silver Snake, Memories by the Painter Beltram Masses. This is takes place in the in Passy, in a hotel at the end of the Via Guibert Street. And I read, with some Americans rushing about, a servant, as he was turning the pages of a giant album, shows a series of paintings by the famous Spanish painter Federico Beltran Massas. Here is the famous Maya du Port, so magical with its background of sails leaving. Here is Salome, who is overthrown with a sadistic pleasure before the head of John. Here, in the shadows of the sunset, the portrait of the King of Spain. Beautiful Venetians in their gondola. Here, in ruby flames, the damned women of Baudelaire. Here are the dreams of pearls and emerald waves. Suddenly, the vision of a happy young couple saddens the audience. It is the legendary Rudolph Valentino with his wife, Natasha Rombova. I question Beltran. His beautiful face fills with emotion, and his lips quiver, recalling his memories. I went to America towards the end of 1924 for the exhibition of my works in New York. There, Rudolph Valentino asked to be introduced to me. He begged me to come to Los Angeles because he was getting ready to film The Eagle and asked that I help him with my personal vision. He spoke Spanish as well as English, French, and Italian, and I lived there for 6 months. He was the simplest human being and the most exquisite person that I've known. He hated exaggeration. He was never seen in snobbish places. He avoided the fashionable beaches. He was astonished at his success. He feared the ovations that his presence inspired when he arrived to any public establishment. He dreamed of having a short but fruitful film career to ensure a peaceful existence. He sang beautifully with the accompaniment of the guitar. He lived in Hollywood in a magnificent villa in the middle of a garden with a modern decor. When we were working for the film, he got up at 5 o'clock in the morning and often worked day and night without stopping. He liked to take my advice. More than one occasion, we went for a swim when he should have been sleeping. When we were not working on the set, we sparred, boxing, rode on horseback, or indulged in painting. Rudolph loved to see me painting landscapes or portraits. I painted the portrait of the beautiful blonde Marion Davis with him watching me work. He had an extraordinary gift of assimilation. One day he took my brushes and handled them with dexterity. You see this painting? And Beltran shows me a canvas that represents, in its way, a half-naked gypsy woman on a blue background. That one which Maurice Donet christened the Blue Beltran. This is the only painting by Rudolph. He gave it to me. You see that he could have become an excellent painter. It was during my stay in Los Angeles that Rudolph and Natasha's separation occurred. I loved them so much, one more than the other, and I was so troubled by their disagreements. He, Rudolph, thought with his head, Natasha with her heart. Me, I stood between them. I told them, be patient, but it did not happen. Rudolph, following this divorce, wanted to commit suicide. I found him one morning, a Browning pistol in his hand, having written his last wishes and ready to make the gesture fatal. I snatched the weapon and threw it into a drawer, shouting, "That's stupid." He agreed, crying in my arms. Since that day, Rudolph called me his brother, and I loved him as a brother, really. He also had a lot of affection and respect for Charlie Chaplin, and I remember that one day we were photographed with Chaplin eating bananas in California. Rudolph from Castellaneta was, as we know, the son of a veterinary doctor. His mother was French. He loved his family, his brother and his sister, and there was too much gossiping about him. He was, I repeat, very simple. He was the first to be surprised by his own successes and the exaggerated cheers. "I do not deserve that," he would say. "And these people, they are simple. All of this reaction, only because I made 4 grimaces. Ah, if I could be what I dream of being. I would like," he told me again, "to disappear in full force, in full health, perhaps in an accident. I cannot find anything more stupid than to die of an illness, of a belly disease, for example. It is ridiculous." And when he said these words, he had but a few months later to be kidnapped by appendicitis. I painted 2 portraits of him, but as we became friends, I asked that he accept these paintings he had ordered from me as gifts. "What could I give you in exchange?" he asked me. "That," I replied, and Beltran pronounces, "Come on, Hollywood, and say hello to me, the gentleman." Hollywood was the name of an admirable dog, a Boston bulldog, with human-like eyes. Oh, no, said Rudy. I love him too much. But when I left Los Angeles, he called out to me on the train station platform saying, I forgot something. He threw himself into his car, and some minutes later he brought me, all packed in this crate, this dog. And this dog is now, to me, doubly dear. It is for me, beloved. Rudolph was very superstitious. One day we were photographed in front of his automobile, whose hood was adorned with a silver snake, a cobra coiled up on himself, lifting his head. I do not know what I possess, Rudolph told me, to love animals so much. They say snakes bring bad luck, but yet I cannot stop to love them. A few months later, unhappily, he was gone. I think he was in love with Polinegri and that he wanted to marry her. In his last letter to me, he wrote, We will be in Paris in December. You will paint her portrait. Beltran then falls silent. In the brutal light of reality, his memories of Valentino depict an intense life.
Great. And the second piece I found on Gallica is from the Spettacolo of October 1st, 1926. It's regarding something Valentino did.
It's called A Gesture by Rudolph Valentino. And the article, the small article reads, Rudolph Valentino was good and generous in all aspects of the term. Here is an example of that, which portrays him entirely. It took place during one of his last trips to Paris. He was dining with some close friends in a restaurant in the Bois du Boulogne, when a poor street woman approached his table, handing him some roses. Valentino had, at the time, a beautiful red carnation as a boutonniere. He removed the boutonniere and wrapped the carnation in a 1,000-franc note. Then he put this in the hand of the woman, saying, Look, your short one carnation. Here is a simple gesture honoring the one who was known as the Magnificent Sheik.
Very well. For today we discuss better masses and some more of setting the record straight about Ullman and you. Next time we will talk about some interesting aspects of your work. The slave bracelet, more about the Lochiel theory, and as always we will report on the work to clean up that online search. For today, I say stay tuned and subscribe to this podcast so you will not miss any new episodes. And as always, arrivederci!